For he on honeydew hath fed and drinks the milk of paradise. As that line of poetry goes, you would think that there would be something akin to a more optimistic MO when it comes to literature. I mean, sure, there are optimistic poems, but oftentimes they tend to be more religious. And the same is true in philosophy. Like, if you look at Leibniz's Best of All Possible Worlds, he himself was, of course, religious and a Christian. You would think, though, that there might be, like somebody asked me the other day, yesterday actually, what's a good book I should read? And I was trying to think of a happy book, and I'm like, I don't know any good happy books. That's why I'm trying to create a new Hope Yoke Theosophia, a body of work that helps us approach the prima causa and have him approach us via logic and sophistication as juxtaposed against naivete and theology, and mere theology. And so, like, you would think there would be more, like, sure, there's Narnia, but that's allegorical. Tolkien didn't like allegory. That's why when Lewis dedicated Screwtape Letters to Tolkien, he didn't like it because he didn't want allegory. He didn't want it to be too didactic. In fact, the Beatles tried to play the Lord of the Rings, but Tolkien didn't give them permission to be characters in the movie with Lord of the Rings. And he wanted to clarify, like, the ring is not nuclear armaments, nor is Sauron Hitler. You can make it that if you want, but he didn't believe in that which was allegorical, but that which was applicable. And in literature, applicable means you can, in any situation you're in life, impute your own ideas of what you're going through into the story. So that's why I think art that preaches is not usually very good. Didactic art just really isn't that much art. That's more propaganda oftentimes. And so I like abstraction because it allows me to really think in terms of chaos and order and Dionysian and Apollonian ideas of madness versus logic. And so I want to be able to impute and superimpose my own ideas and experiences onto the abstraction. And so all that to say, there's not a whole lot of uplifting art, right? Like, or uplifting literature specifically. Like, even Catcher in the Rye is incredibly dark. It's just incredibly nuanced in how dark it is. So I want to tell you, through sophistication, that there is a way that you don't have to succumb to. I mean, I know I use this quote all the time, but where the most ancient and modern serpents are, they always say where the tree of knowledge is, there is paradise. I mean, knowledge actually doesn't make you happier. It makes it worse sometimes. So this is the thing. There is a way to experience gnosko that is not predicated or contingent on the brain. You know there's neurons in your gut? Like, you have close to as many neurons in your gut as a dog does in its brain. Like, there is a second brain. It's in your gut. It's the splagnon. It's instinct. It comes from the sky. It comes from somewhere else. It's called intuition. What's intuition? Who knows? What's instinct? Who knows? It's not just the corpus callosum where, you know, women are more spatially aware of where their kids are because there's more activity in the corpus callosum connected to the two hemispheres of the brain, or the emotion part where the amygdala is the almond-shaped set of nuclei, or the left part of the brain where emotion is. Like, we're talking about something that isn't totally dictated by neuronal activity, although there are neurons in the gut. And not even just like what's interesting is the mysticism of selected serotonin reuptake inhibitors. Like, in order for the presynaptic neuron not to reuptake, to be inhibited from reuptaking the serotonin, which is the feel-good chemical, in order to get to the postsynaptic neuron, we don't even know exactly how SSRIs work to make you feel happier, but they can chemically make you feel better. It's a mystery. We don't know how they work. There's mysterious things going on. And I know that's in the realm of science, and maybe one day we'll figure it out. But maybe not. Like, I would assume we would, but maybe not. I mean, either way, there is a place of instinct, intuition, the sky. You just know things instinctively. So this is what I want to tell you. Trust your instincts. Trust your instincts. I am not talking about anxieties, okay? Because the thoughts that come in your head, just because you think them does not mean they're true. They will come and they will go. And sometimes our thoughts make us believe things are bad, and your instinct tells you it's fight, fright, freeze. No. Flight, fight, fright, freeze. No, that's not what I'm saying. I'm talking about your deeper instincts of what you know you're supposed to do, of how you know things really are. Trust your instinct. Now, if you live by your instinct, you become the Ubermensch. Maybe you can't have a society of supermen because if my value system is opposed to your structure of morality, then you're in trouble. Like, can you have a society that way? But I'm glad I have a garbage truck that comes every Wednesday, but I don't know. I mean, the society that we have now is a farce, and the great authors and philosophers understand this. Progress in society is a stupid superstition in the Emile Chorin sense. I know I've talked about that before, but like, society is a It's laughable. It's hilarious. It's egregious, incorrigible, and unconscionable. But still, I believe that, I know this might be magical thinking, but if we, because we don't know what a society of supermen would really look like, but if we all live like the Ubermenschen and we live by instinct, I know Nietzsche was a nihilist and an anti-nihilist at the same time, but I'm actually a hope dealer who integrates nihilism into my thinking, but lands at a place of sheer unapologetic optimism. What I'm trying to tell you is this, like live off your instincts. What do you know you're supposed to do? What do you know is true? I'm not talking about my truth, subjective. I'm saying, what do you know in your gut? And this is a place of hope that I'm talking about. Trust your hope instincts. Trust your hope instincts. I'm not saying to be naive. I'm just saying, like, what am I supposed to do? Well, trust your hope. Trust your instincts. I'm not saying go trust people and then get your heart broken by them. I'm saying, like, what you're supposed to do with your life. So there's a sophisticated way to find hope. It's instinct, intuition. C.S. Lewis said, we don't know what instinct is. Instinct is just another word for who knows what it is. We don't know where it comes from. Because there's knowledge that doesn't just come from the brain. It comes from the sky. It doesn't come from the tree of knowledge to ruin paradise. It comes from somewhere else.